Hello and welcome to this brief overview of Silhouette version 6. My name is Ben Brownlee from Curious Turtle, and we're going to be taking a quick look at the new user interface in Silhouette. If you've worked with previous versions of Silhouette, you can already see this is quite a difference. So let's start by adding some media. And we can import media either by going to File, Import, Media, and then by browsing and finding the files we want. And as we load them in, our sources all appear in the Sources window in the bottom left-hand side. And I can import multiple sources here just by double-clicking in the window, finding another piece, and we can bring in as many pieces of media as we need to. And these can be organized in thumbnail view, as we see here, or in list view with thumbnails, or in simple list form. And this will show us the file name, the range of the frames we've taken in, the frame length, the resolution, and at what bit depth our files are. And I'm just going to keep this in thumbnail view for now. So now we've got our media imported into our project, we have to start up a session so that we can work on it. And starting up a session, we can do it in one of a few ways. We can either come up to Session, New Session. We can come down to the button in the bottom left-hand corner of the Sources window, start a new session there. Or we can simply drag and drop one of the source material up into the Trees window in the top right-hand corner. And that will start a new session, and it will ask us what we want to call it. And I will call this one UIBen01. And here we can then decide what format it's going to be. If we've dragged and dropped, it will default the session size to the size of the media that you've used. And in this case, it's 1920 by 1080 with a pixel aspect ratio of 1, duration 60 pixels at 24 frames per second. We can change this if we need to and set our start frame. And again, this is picking up from the frame number of the original source material. Hit OK on that. So now we'll take a quick look into the viewer window in the top left. Now, the viewer is obviously where we're going to be viewing things. And depending on the node we're working on at any time, we'll see different viewer options coming down in this drop-down menu in the view in the top left-hand corner. We also have options to change when the viewer updates, whether it's going to update as we drag along on the effect or shape, or whether it will go into adaptive mode, which means it will drop down the resolution if it needs to so that it can process in as close to real time as possible, or release when we release the mouse button, or manual, which means we'll only update when we hit the enter button. And the manual update is good for render intensive processes where you may be setting up an effect and you don't need to see what it's doing all the time. Say, for example, if you're setting up a morph or warp. And we also have the ability to move into a proxy viewing mode as well. At the moment, we're seeing things at 1:1, but we can take this down to 2:1, 3:1, or 4:1 resolution. And this will, of course, speed up any processes we've got. But of course, we won't be able to make pixel accurate decisions based on this view. A new feature we have in version 6 is the ability to take a snapshot. So by taking a snapshot, we're now able to then compare this frame to any frame that comes before or after it, wherever we are in our node tree. So this will become a bit more important later on, but it means we can compare and contrast the same piece of footage at different stages within our session, or we can use it to match up two different pieces of footage if we need to do color correction, for example. And we can choose whether we're going to just simply toggle the snapshot in an A-B sort of mode, or whether we're going to have a vertical split or a horizontal split. And just by clicking on the button one more time, we then turn off the view snapshot. Another new feature in version 6 is the region of interest, or ROI. And clicking on this will show us our current session size, 1920 by 1080, the domain of definition, which is embedded into a source file, if we're working with EXR files, for example, and what this can do is it can tell us whether there's overscan information available to us that we're not seeing in the image itself. But we can use the region of interest to open up and reveal the overscan pictures, or we can use it to define our region of interest so that effects process faster. So let's take our viewer down to fit to view, for example, and we can see our region of interest bounding box here. So if, for example, I was interested only in what's going on in this corner here, and I can turn my region of interest off now, I'm now focused just on this little corner of the screen here. And because I don't have to process out all the rest of these pixels, it's going to be playing this back and processing out my effect a lot faster. If at any point I want to reveal the whole image again, I can just come back to my region of interest and either disable it, and it will remember where I've been to, or I can completely reset it to the original settings. Coming over to our right-hand corner, we have our trees window. And this is where a lot of the important work is going to get done. Because instead of using modules, as the older versions of Silhouette did, we now have a nodal-based structure to work with. And if we look down at the bottom middle section here, we can see a list of our nodes that we have available to us. If we come to the Silhouette category, we have the core Silhouette nodes, the roto, the paint, the morph, as well as some new ones including depth, Zmat, which replaces the old Kia, and roto blend. So to add a node in, we can either click and drag it from our node window and just drag it over the top, and that will create a new connection, or let's undo that with Command or Control Z, or I can click and drag it in between two of the other nodes, and as soon as that connection goes blue and let go there, that will then connect that node in between those two others. Another way of adding nodes is just to also simply double click, and that will put a node right in the middle there. If we have no node selected and I double click again here, it will just place the node into the trees area itself. Let's undo that one more time, and I can also right click and I have a list of my nodes right here. So if I know I want to add a roto here, I can just bring that in and then connect it up. If we do have a node that's just floating around and not connected to anything, we can connect it by bringing it in and it will snap in and connect for us. If we want to take a node out, we can use a gesture, we can grab the node, shake it about a little bit, and it will come loose. And we can do the same thing by using the buttons at the top. So using extract to just remove that node from our tree here. We can turn nodes on and off by using the enable state toggle here, or by using D to disable or re-enable the node. Bring it back in. And once you've built up your tree how you like it, and you might want to save this out to either recycle a particular effect that you've created or to share the workspace with other people, you can use these final two buttons to save those nodes or load them. And this will save the selected nodes out as a separate file. So if I add another node here, let's say I add, let's come over to my film lab and use a film stocks in here. I have other useful controls hidden within tabs. So down here, I have my timeline tabbed up, and over in my inspector window over here, I have my node parameters, my object parameters, presets, which I can use and apply. And even favorite, if I find one that I really like, boom, adds it as a favorite, which I can then filter to favorites. And any notes that I might want to write within this particular node. So for example, suitable look, question mark, and hit apply. And the final thing to note as we look at the UI is how we move between these particular nodes. If I double click on a node, it's going to change the viewer to that node and change the parameters window so that I can see what that node is doing. What I can also do is I can use these two buttons on the side of the node. So if I click just on the screen here, you'll see the view is highlighted, so I'm seeing this node in the viewer. But over on here, my edit node button is active on the roto, so I'm seeing the roto controls down in my parameters. So in this way, we can be editing one node while viewing the result downstream in a completely different node. And that's our quick look at the user interface in Silhouette version 6.